you, if you need more champagne, just make sure that you make it very obvious. But just to kind of start things off, I don't know how many of you have had the chance to meet Iris yet, but we've been so fortunate to have her as part of our family, maybe a little unofficially, but but she's been on lots of trips with us, and we've Bert and I have been dating for about nine years, so she's basically part of the family. This is just more kind of a formalization of everything. And we had a wonderful time in May at this wedding that Iris planned, and it was in Mexico, which my mom I thought would never want to ever go to. But Iris did such a wonderful job planning that wedding. At various points, my mom was dancing with her shoes off and saying, "This is the best wedding I've ever been to." So I think anybody that can get Pauline Fan happy on a beach in Mexico is pretty special. And that's true. Iris is incredibly special to us. We're just so thrilled that Bert met Iris, and I've said it many times, but Bert's a wonderful person, and he's really shy sometimes, and kind of clueless sometimes, but really just such a good person, and we're all really proud of him for so many reasons. I mean, just in terms of his career and what he's done, but also just he's just a special person, and I feel really fortunate just to have him in my life, and the fact that we share DNA is pretty damn cool. So anyway, I'd like to make a toast to Bert and Iris. Cheers. To Bert and Iris. And okay, and so we're going to have Dave come up next. Dave is Bert's best friend since third grade.
Thank you. Hey, everybody.
Hey.
I'm a little bigger than I was in third grade. I'm going to try to channel that moment so I can remember meeting Bert. I'm feeling very thankful tonight, very grateful. I'm going to keep it short and sweet so you guys can enjoy the soup, but I'm feeling very grateful for having known Bert for 25 years. I've seen him grow up and change and go from kind of a sneaky jokester, prankster guy, into like a more mature, sincere, empathic, sneaky jokester, prankster. I'm feeling very thankful for Bert's family, who I've known for just as long, and they've been so generous to me for so long. Bert, they carted me all over the place, including Rome, where I met some people who are here tonight.
Dave, I'm still waiting for it.
I'm feeling very thankful for that. And kind of, you know, I was thinking about it along the same vein of how feeling thankful for how, despite having known Bert for 25 years, we've both managed to change so much and kind of change in a way that we're still, I don't know, we still work really well together and can get along very well. And so I think the final thing I'm feeling thankful for is that Bert met Iris, who is also somebody who I think has been able to grow and change with him as he's gone from Mr. Adventure Travel Man, kind of can't pin me down, to now Mr. Adventure Travel Man, but a little bit more responsible, a little more grounded. I'm feeling very happy for the two of them, that they were able to kind of share that experience together. So, a toast to Bert and Iris, and to the things we feel thankful for.
Cheers.
So,
to begin with, Pauline and I really want to thank you. We're very honored that you're here tonight to kind of celebrate Bert and Iris one more time. You know, as the immortal Yogi Berra says, is deja vu all over again. Very happy occasion. I'm sorry that you weren't there because it was a great party. Just went on all night with tequila from... where was that, Audrey? The tequila started?
I don't know, but it was really great because I didn't have a hangover after all those.
He had shot after shot from 7 to maybe to midnight, right? We were, so drink more. The more you drink, the better my speech is. So as you know, I've kind of gone through a rather checkered career, and growing up, it was my ambition to learn and to know everything that was contemporaneous in the world, in art, literature, in medicine, in science. And thinking back, I mean, the two greatest things that I accomplished were really my kids. So I think that still basically is the most important. Not being religious, that's probably my only chance at immortality to pass a little bit of DNA on to the next generation. And fortunately for me, I had two very bright, very independent spirits, which is sort of code for pain in the asses. But they have done well. They've both done well. Bertrand came when he was born with huge burdens, because I announced his birth with a little poem by Wordsworth, you know, probably the greatest romantic poet. And he was named, not accidentally, Bertrand George Fan, after the two intellectual heroes of my childhood. Bertrand Russell, who I still consider the greatest philosopher of the 20th century, although some might argue with me, like maybe David might say Heidegger or Wittgenstein, but I'm still a Russell person. And George is after George Orwell, who it remains today my touchstone and my intellectual conscience. If I do something, I would say, would Orwell approve that, you know, even today. So, but Bertrand has turned out well, and he's proudly gone forward, and he's got a lovely wife. The two of them, I'm sure, would have a very, very happy and bright career. Since you missed the first go-around, I thought, if you like, I'll read you the little excerpt from The Little Prince that I gave during the ceremony. Audrey, is that okay? Or is
it
too long?
It's okay. We all say it. Yeah. 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 It's okay. We say
do it. All night.
Do that, like, what can I say, right? Yeah, so anyway, so when I was at the ceremony, this is what I read, and Iris and Bertrand wanted me to read a poem, but Iris's father is a published poet. I wasn't going to read a poem. That would be bringing Coase to Newcastle. Those of you who don't know Coase to Newcastle is like doing the redundant thing, you know? So I read, I got a little excerpt from The Little Prince, a book that I'm sure many of you have read in childhood. So I said, this is from a small magical little book called The Little Prince, which was written by a novelist and an aviator and a great poet, Antoine de Saint-Exupéry. So this is the story. The little prince fell to the earth from an asteroid and landed in the Sahara Desert. There he met a fox. "Who are you?" asked the little prince, and he added, "You are very pretty to look at." "I'm a fox," the fox said. "Come and play with me," proposed the little prince. "I am so unhappy." "I cannot play with you," the fox said. "I am not tamed." "What does that mean, tamed?" "It is an act too often neglected," said the fox. "It means to establish ties." "To establish ties?" "Just that," said the fox. "To me, you are still nothing more than a little boy who is just like 100,000 other little boys. and I have no need of you. And you, on the other hand, have no need of me. To you, I am nothing more than a fox like 100,000 other foxes. But if you tame me, then we shall need each other. To me, you will be unique in all the world. To you, I shall be unique in all the world. My life is very monotonous, the fox said. I hunt chickens, men hunt me. All the chickens are just alike, and all the men are just alike. And in consequence, I am a little bored. But if you tame me, it will be as if the sun came to shine on my life. I shall know the sound of a step that will be different from all the others. Other steps send me hurrying back under the ground. Yours will call me like music out of my burrow. And then look, you see the grain fields over there, down yonder? I do not eat bread. Wheat is of no use to me. The wheat fields have nothing to say to me, and that is sad. But if you have, you have hair the color of gold. Think how wonderful that will be when you have tamed me. The grain, which is also golden, will bring back the thought of you, and I shall love to listen to the wind in the wheat. The fox gazed at the little prince for a long time. Please, tame me, he said. I want to very much, the little prince replied, but I have not much time. I have friends to discover and a great many things to understand. One only understands the things that one tames, says the fox. Men have no more time to understand anything. They buy things already made at the shops, but there is no shop anywhere where one can buy friendship. And so men have no friends anymore. If you want a friend, tame me. What must I do to tame you? Said the little prince. You must be very patient, replied the fox. First you will sit down at a little distance from me, like that, in the grass. I shall look at you out of the corner of my eye, and you will say nothing. Words are the source of misunderstandings. But you will sit a little closer to me every day. So the little prince tamed the fox. One day he said goodbye to the fox. Goodbye, said the fox. And now here is my secret. It is a very simple secret. One sees clearly only with the heart. What is essential is invisible to the eye. Thank you. To Bert and Iris.
Yes. Salud.
Cheers to the little prince.
We wanted to thank you all for coming out and to celebrate this with us. We're going to actually do this every 3 months.
Good idea.
This is my wife Iris, for those of you that haven't met her. Actually, we're gonna do a reading from David Copperfield, three chapters. No. Enjoy yourself.
Thank you, Father.
This event actually has two different meanings for us. It's actually my dad is turning 70 years old. And I wrote a little something to honor that occasion. So my father's turning 70 years old this month, and next month I'll be 35 years old, same age he was when I was born. It's a strange thing to be half your father's age. I thought about the math, actually, and I wondered, is this the first time that this has occurred? So I wrote a computer program and ran it. I'm going to confirm that to be true. But the more important realization that I had was that I had crafted a logic puzzle for myself and found a way to solve it, and that I truly am my father's son. because my dad loves puzzles. We'll be sitting at a restaurant waiting for the food to arrive, and he'll tell Audrey and I a puzzle. And if we can't work it out, he'll take a pen out of his front pocket and draw it out on the map. And he'll tell us a joke or tell us about a book he just read. Because in addition to loving puzzles, he also loves art and music and philosophy and technology and computers and movies and history and politics and medicine and food and travel and jokes and books. He has an insatiable curiosity about the world. The desire to learn that is so strong that he could have done anything, but fortunately he chose to practice medicine and fall in love with my mom and raise a family and instill that same curiosity in them. It is a hell of a thing to start from nothing, to immigrate to another country, to define a field of medicine, and to raise two children who also believe that they can do anything if they're willing to learn. Half lives of a legacy. So let's raise a toast to Ping, who is still learning, and makes him closer than any of us to figuring it all out.
Cheers!
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. Audrey, that line's been used.
My best wishes for the wedding. However, that's not what they asked me to talk about. Something about the old guy.
Okay.
Peng and I met 44 years ago at LAC, at Los Angeles County USC Medical Center. We were assigned cardiology. I was the resident. He was the intern. Of course, he had the brain, so it was very helpful for me. we became friends very shortly after that. In 1964, our Cadillac convertible was used in Peng and Poland's wedding. And then my wife Robin and I stayed with Poland's parents in Singapore in 1972. Periodically, we have touched each other's lives ever since. The last event was the 30th, now that we clarify it, the 30th wedding anniversary. I was given no notice, but I've had a chance to put this thing over. I was told I was too serious at that time, so I thought what you needed to know is something, some other things about him. He's going to have a chance to respond to it. What I did was pick five small vignettes, which I thought you might be interested in. And believe me, they're very short, but it's very simple. Did you know that Peng was an auto fanatic? Did you know that?
What is Pusha?
It is true. For example, as an intern, he bought a Pontiac GTO, which had more horsepower than any other car in the hospital. Why he bought that, I never understood. The last time I heard about it, I believe it was dead in the parking lot. I wonder if it's still there. Okay, the next episode was Peng and Poland making a trip around the country a year or so later after their wedding. They were in a Datsun, you can correct me if I'm not, it was a Datsun B210 that they went in. And when they came back after a couple of weeks, they said, did you go very far? It was somewhere 8,000 or 10,000 miles. I said, you mean to tell me you're in this Datsun for that length of time and traveling that far? For those of you that don't know what a B210 is, it's somewhere between a Mini Cooper and a smart car. I think it's impressive that the marriage lasted. Okay, the next event, did you know that he was involved in forest management and he was an early environmentalist? when he stayed in our eccentric Mount Washington rental house while we were in Singapore with Poland's family. At that time, he decided the smart thing to do was to get rid of some of the leaves. So he raked them all up and burned them. In Los Angeles, that doesn't go over well. And the neighbors in the fire department did not think that was good. Okay, then the fourth thing that is important that you realize is that he is an email aficionado. Anybody who gets his emails knows what this is about. My computer is so slow, and I'm convinced it's because of the stack of emails of pigs. And then I would like to ask, how many of you looked at the time of day that he sends them? Yeah. I mean, come on. I think it's all night, but it's day and night, so I can't figure out when he goes around how he does this. All right. Then the fourth is books. The number of books are absolutely impressive at their house. Now, but my concern is, if he gets any more books, or if it ever rains in Los Angeles, I think that Glendale Hill House is going to go right down into the finally, which doesn't need to be said, he's my definition of a Renaissance man. He's a master of George Orwell, things literary, and all the other things that Bertram discussed. He's an outstanding and distinguished physician who combines practice of medicine, research, teaching, and he is a world lecturer, as most of you know. I will never forget Peng telling me many years ago, "Ben, there will soon be an important article in the New England Journal of Medicine about gay men having a newly discovered devastating viral illness." As most of you know, Peng was involved in the original research and publication about HIV. In summary, Peng, you are a loyal friend, a hard act to follow. Thank you for sharing, and happy birthday.
There's...
I've gotten rheumatoid arthritis, which is why I met Peng. I met him in 1980, so that's 35 years. I can't top Ben. I was having my first knee replacement, and he was the rheumatologist assigned to sort of see me through the recovery. It was kind of a tough operation. But we started talking, and I started to talk about political philosophy, which is what I teach, and he started talking about science, and I was in there a while, so every day we'd talk a little more, and pretty soon we became friends in 1980. Now, the thesis of, so I'm a professor, so the thesis of this little talk is how brilliant it is. You can see it in the fact that right now he's doing better political philosophy than I am. So I haven't caught up in medicine at all, but he's way caught up in philosophy. And I remember talking about Nietzsche with him. I also remember the 80s when, if you had aggressive rheumatoid arthritis like I did, there was really nothing a rheumatologist could do. You could try all these anti-malarial drugs and a Varigold and all these other things, but they didn't really work until you got to methotrexate and Enbrel, as some of you know and some of you don't. And through all that period, I sort of lived at his office sort of every week. And he would say to me, he was calm, you know, nothing to worry about. Don't get worried, just a little arthritis. So I come in with a sed rate, some of you know that, some of you don't, of 122, and he'd say, "We don't treat sed rates." And then I'd come in with a sed rate of 50, and he'd say, "That's really good." So I'm not dumb, I could figure out that it mattered. But there was this one time, he remembered it too, he just said to me, that in the 80s, you know, we tried everything. And basically, I could see on his face there was nothing left to do. And so he wrote things out then about what you should do, you know, when you go home. Take this medicine, do this exercise, or whatever. And he wrote, he took another page of paper and he wrote, subspecies eternitas. And that, I had Latin in high school, and that says, basically, in the eyes of God and the universe, none of us matters. Including me. So that was sort of a low point, but he got me on Enbrel, and, you know, the sin rate went down literally to zero, and, you know, he's a real hero in my mind. But I have a story, one story to tell to illustrate how smart this guy is. He keeps sending me emails thinking I still read philosophy. I basically moved over to literature. So, anyway, around in the mid-80s, we were desperately looking for a good HMO. You know, HMOs were forming everywhere, and some of them were terrible. There was a terrible one in Pasadena. And then there was a good one, and he told me that to go see a certain doctor whom he went to medical school with in Canada. And so we went and made an appointment just to see if I could get in the HMO. And the actual answer at that time was, no, I couldn't because I had an ongoing condition. But yes, Mandy could, my wife, because she's perfectly healthy. You know, it's sort of before Obamacare kind of medicine. Anyway, he called me back and said he would, I could get him. Anyway, so he said, who referred you here? And I said, Payne Fan. He said, Payne Fan. Payne Fan, he said. I went to medical school with Payne Fan. All I ever saw him do was play bridge. He played bridge while we were studying till blood came out of our fingernails. He played bridge and we were studying and exhausted, and he popped up and went to the test and got 100, left early, and we all were really relieved to get a seat. That's the smartest guy I've ever met, the doctor in Pasadena. He said, not only do I want you to join the HMO, I want you to bring Payne Fan into the HMO.
You'll never do it.
And that's how I made it.
You realize that HMO means humorous medical option. You have the wrong idea. So, you are here to have a tea. You are the way around. Or something like that. But Meg and I have been hiking for how many years?
At least 10, I guess.
A bunch of hikers. Three or four of them are here. Bruno,
David, Carlo.
David. Every hike, the funny hikes. We have a hike to St. Gabriel, so we have a hike from the Vidal Mountains. And every hike, about two-thirds of the way up, Ben turns to one of us and says, remind me, why are we doing it?
Two-thirds of the way, right from the beginning.
No fear. And I give him the same answer every time, but it doesn't stop him from asking me again. And the answer is, so you can ask the question next. But the hikes are very interesting. Link characterizes them as going to the university. Lessons on Heidegger, George Orwell, which I discovered through Tang and came to love. But we also sing opera. Fortunately, Bruno was born in Italy, so Italian opera usually takes first place. Talk about science a little bit. I teach here at Caltech.
So I'd say that, as a matter of fact, to give you an idea of people who are talking about Peng's knowledge of books and love of books, we had a few minutes here and we exchanged information, and I told Peng that I'm reading The Prime Minister by Anthony Trollope. Peng says, oh, that's the middle book of the Palliser series. The six book series. So now I have five more books to read.
Gracias. Gracias.
Also, Peng taught me probably two-thirds of the Jewish jokes. And I'm the one who speaks Yiddish. So anyhow, I wasn't prepared to give the talk. I think that hopefully I gave you a sample of my impression of Peng.
Anyway, thank you.
Great fun. And Peng, why are we doing it?
Second page. Only after the page that he wrote to my best friend. Well, actually, kidding aside, he's so smart, he went on to rheumatology. And he did some really good things in the years that we were looking at HIV patients. I was a honorary fellow, so I did a lot of work with pentamidine, treating the HIV, not HIV at that time, pentamidine treating the pneumocystis. And I saw so many patients at the county hospital, but when I went in out in practice, I saw some patients that were young, and had nothing related to chemotherapy related immunodeficiency. And I'm pretty sure Ben will know that too. At that time, there were a couple of cases that I saw in also saw those cases. And it was published in the New England Journal of Medicine back in the case. And it was to be recovered. And who's the other guy?
Gottlieb.
Michael Gottlieb. Okay? Michael Gottlieb. So this is very, very interesting. And King always go travel around different places. One time I was going to a meeting, and you know who I bumped into in the Burbank Airport? Running each other like this. And we look, oh, Peng. So you're just coming back from this whirlwind lecture series everywhere. And Peng has been inspirational to the kid. And I know the doctor that he sent you to, HMO.
You're right.
One is in England, one is in Switzerland right now.
Yes, he is. Okay. He may have come back to Ohio on this slide.
And it has created a law and order in the practice of medicine in creating an environment for health care, doing the preventive care health, which is very important. And above that, I think that Obamacare is actually done very well for the population that we understand.
Yay, Obamacare!
I don't think you say something, you'll leave this country if someone won the election.
Yeah, try.
He still stays. Thank you.
So, I don't have much more to add to my father. I'd like to kind of tell something. I remember when I was And back then it was kind of a big deal because there was this idea that, you know, in Chinese families, you always want to have a son, especially as your firstborn. That I was just like, oh, okay, that's great. And I always tried to understand why, and then it kind of came out. It's like, well, your mom is just so gorgeous and so beautiful. And so if you had a daughter, then it would, you'd have your mom's looks and your father's brains. I got a combo of, well, fortunately my mom is brilliant also. I was kind of sad. But anyway, my father is somebody who's always wonderful and making me just feel very loved. Just the little things even. Just happened to be went out for Chinese food just a couple days ago. And my father just kept saying, this is the best piece. Best piece. Or when we go out for like a whole piece of fish, he always makes sure I get the cheek of the fish because it's the most delicate, tender piece of the fish. So it's the little things and the big things as well. I'm incredibly fortunate. I'm incredibly fortunate to just be who I am, I guess, in that regard. Some of you may know I work in genetics, and I'm actually kind of like in an academic medical center, and so I've started to kind of spread my wings a little bit, and I'll give grand rounds talks or present at different meetings, and I've had these couple of moments where people will ask me a question, and I start to answer it, and then I realize I have the same mannerisms as my father. When he's thinking deeply, like when you're thinking and answering something at the same time, I sound like my father. It's really scary. I might giggle a little bit more, throw in a couple more likes into her. Essentially, I kind of sound like Ping. It's creepy. Anyway, I'd like to kind of set the record straight on my father and HIV, because it's a very classic story. But the big story is essentially my father, as you know, is a brilliant diagnostician. I think that he's a very good doctor, a very good clinician, but one of his really unique aspects is being a diagnostician, the idea of just being able to hunt things down and figure out what's going on. And so with the whole, everyone's kind of alluding to the HIV thing, I'd kind of like just to clarify that. Essentially, my father was in practice, and there were his colleagues trying to figure out what was going on with these men, these young gay men, and they could not figure out what was going on there. And so they sent him to Ping, who was the Chinese wizard, I believe. Dominique LaPierre wrote a book about this whole thing and called my father the Chinese wizard, which I thought was hilarious. But my father would see these men, and he couldn't figure out what they had. And the way he likes to describe it is like, well, I know everything, so if I can't figure out what they have, it must be a new disease. And that's essentially how he concluded that this was a brand new disease. And, you know, for a lot of people, that would be kind of gutsy to say that. But in my father's case, because it was my dad, it actually was true. It was a new disease. And so that's how that they discovered that HIV was a new phenomenon. And so you look for my father's paper in the New England Journal of Medicine, though, it doesn't say anything about HIV because they hadn't named it yet. But that's the story of my dad. So he's humorously arrogant to the benefit of mankind, I suppose. but anyway. Thank you so much for coming tonight, and thank you for letting us celebrate my father, my brother, my new sister, and thank you again for coming tonight. I'd like to do one more toast, so please raise your glasses.
Absolutely.
Mm-hmm. To wonderful friends and our huge California family.
Thank you. Yes.
Those relighting kind of
Wow, that's it.
Thank you.
Thanks to my brain notes, we're here.
Video. So it's
<That's mean. laughs>
Hallelujah.
Copper. I try to assume it. Whenever I wear your jewelry, I always get all these compliments. Yeah.
So, like, I think right before the holiday.